You know, watching kids grow up is an amazing thing, isn't it? Even if you aren't a parent, those of you who have been in this church a while have watched little ones grow up, maybe even into adults with kiddos of their own. My boys are 5 and 2. Liam, who's sitting right here with his mother, he's our oldest. He impresses me all the time with his maturity. That same little boy who preferred crawling under the pews to sitting in them during VBS also frequently says things that demonstrate wisdom, insight, and awareness beyond his years. Charlie, his little brother, is talking more and more all the time. When we came here, pretty much 2 years ago this next Sunday. 2 years ago this next Sunday is when our family had our first Sunday in this church. And when we came, Charlie, our little one, was still a 9-month-old infant, and now he's an energetic, talkative, and friendly little toddler. Charlie was hanging out with me in my office this past week, and we had a little conversation. Take a look.
What are you doing, Charlie?
Coloring.
You're coloring? What's your name?
Huh?
What's your name? If somebody asks you who you are, what do you say? That's how old you are.
Two.
Yeah? But what's your name?
Charlie.
Charlie Baker. Who's your brother?
Yeah.
Is his last name Baker too? Is he Liam Baker?
Liam Baker.
Yeah. And who am I?
Daddy Baker.
Daddy Baker. And who's that lady who lives in our house with us? Mommy? What do you like to eat? Is that funny?
Eat
peanut butter and jelly sandwich and what? And strawberries? That sounds a lot better than poop. What's that a picture of? What's that a picture of? What are you drawing? What is that?
Batman.
Is Batman? Is Batman saving the day? You love Batman? Okay.
Batman flies.
Batman flies? Are you sure? You sure you're not thinking about Superman?
At one time, Charlie couldn't say 2 words, and he certainly showed no indication of understanding what we were saying, but now he's having full conversations with me. Granted, some of my questions confused him, but for the most part, he knew what I was saying, and he knew how to respond. He certainly got room to grow, but he's already grown and matured so much, and as his dad, I'm thrilled to see the progress he's made. Now, here's my point. God loves us no matter what, just like I love Charlie and Liam no matter what. It doesn't matter how silly Liam can be or that Charlie isn't a master conversationalist yet. I love them anyway. Now, sure, I want Liam to grow more and more mature. I want him to learn to be able to behave in a way appropriate to his setting. I want Charlie's conversational skills to improve, but the fact that I want to see them grow and mature doesn't take away from how much I love them. The same goes for us in God. God loves us no matter what, but he does want us to grow and mature. It doesn't matter how quickly or how slowly we mature, though, and it doesn't matter how many setbacks we might have along the way, God still loves us. In fact, he wants to nurture us along the way. He wants to help us mature. God is not standing over us ready to smite us when we fall. God is cheering us on. God is encouraging us. Often, God is even training us like a coach might train an athlete, all with the goal of nurturing righteousness in us, all with the goal of strengthening us morally and spiritually, making our character more like that of Jesus, the only human being who was ever truly and fully righteous. Last week, I shared with you all the good news that being on good terms with God is not about checking off a list of do's and don'ts. It's about embracing God's love for us, demonstrated through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. It's about embracing God's forgiveness of all we've done wrong. That forgiveness is made possible by that same Jesus who gave himself up as a sacrifice, a peace offering, if you will, mending the relationship between humanity and God the Father. We are free from the burden of guilt, shame, and fear that comes from not being assured that we are on good terms with God. But what comes next? What comes after getting back on good terms with God? What comes next is a life of growth or maturation that comes from letting God's Holy Spirit train us to be righteous. In his letter to the Christians in Galatia, Paul writes, "You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly in love." Jesus gives us freedom from guilt and shame before God the Father, but he does it for a reason. He does it for a purpose. We are not freed from the guilt and power of our wrongdoing just to go right back to it. We are freed to do what is right. And according to Paul, the opposite of doing what is right is what he calls indulging the flesh. Now let's talk about this idea of the flesh a little bit before we continue. Now this verse, as it's on the screen in front of you, is taken from the New International Version. That's a translation of the Bible that was updated in 2011. Now the original NIV was translated in 1984, and instead of saying flesh, it said sinful nature. However, before 1984, most English translations said flesh. So it started out flesh. In 1984, they changed it to sinful nature. And then in 2011, they took it back to flesh. Why? Well, because frankly, it's a better translation. The word used is the word sarx. And when used literally, it refers to the physical body. It's also used to refer to the baser animalistic side of human beings, the raw and untamed part of us that simply comes from being earthly creatures. Human beings are like other earthly creatures in many ways. First of all earthly creatures, including human beings, have instincts. There's the self-preservation instinct. There's hunger, thirst, the desire for comfort, the reproductive impulse. These are all simple, basic compulsions that contribute to survival. Now, more biologically advanced creatures, mainly mammals, are capable of more complex inner motivations that we call emotion. Emotions are caused by chemical reactions in the brain. They give nuance to our basic instincts and extra energy, motivating us to act. Emotions generally fall into one of four categories: mad, sad, glad, or afraid. Although even those four categories each have a broad spectrum of feelings within them. And then we get to the intellect. Apes, dolphins, and whales demonstrate a surprising ability to think and reason, but as far as we can tell, the intellect is far more developed in humans than any other creatures on Earth. We have the ability to think abstractly, to imagine, to envision. In other words, unlike apes and dolphins, we are able to comprehend not just what is, but what could be or what might be. We have even conceived of things beyond what can be seen and touched. That is the beginning of what makes human beings special. But all of these, instinct, emotion, and intellect, are all part of what we are as created beings. Yes, emotions are more advanced than instinct. Intellect is more advanced than emotion. Emotion gives instinct a greater degree of nuance and precision. Intellect has the power to override both emotion and instinct in the interest of the big picture or the long term. But all of them have some connection to the physical body, particularly the brain. They are part of the flesh. Now, they are all three useful sources of information and insight, but they are limited, they're flawed, they're imperfect. Instinct can be reckless and selfish. Emotion can make us behave foolishly and uncontrollably. And the intellect can make errors in logic or have access to limited information. The will, the part of us that chooses, needs a lot more to go on if we want to live lives that fulfill our God-given potential. That's where conscience comes in. The conscience is a gift of God's Holy Spirit. It's the means by which the Holy Spirit speaks to us. All of these human faculties are part of who we are, and they give us the necessary information to thrive, but instinct must be subject to emotion, emotion must be subject to intellect, and all of them must be subject to Holy Spirit-guided conscience. Being trained in righteousness means learning to tell the difference among these different faculties, developing the self-discipline to subjugate lower faculties to higher ones, and teaching the intellect how to recognize the voice of God as spoken to us through our consciences. To be sure, God's voice will always be in tune with one thing. As Paul next writes, the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command: love your neighbor as yourself. The commands of God are still useful to us, even though we don't obey them in the sense of a checklist of do's and don'ts. They are still useful because they provide us with a standard for recognizing God speaking to our consciences. Simply put, God's word, as communicated in the scriptures, teaches us to recognize God's voice. Jesus said that along with loving God with all our hearts, this command to love one's neighbor as oneself was the greatest commandment. Nothing God ever commands us to do will run contrary to the most sacred commandment, to desire good for others just as we desire it for ourselves. But learning to live out that principle requires us to prioritize what the Spirit tells us through our consciences over what our lower faculties, our flesh, tell us. If you bite and devour each other, watch out, or you will be destroyed by each other. So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so that you are not to do whatever you want. Friends, instinct just wants to maximize pleasure and minimize pain. Emotion by itself is just undirected energy, and undirected energy is dangerous. And even the intellect is subject to bias and error. Often our natural fleshly faculties are at odds with what God's Spirit is telling us through our conscience. But training in righteousness means learning to tell the difference. Paul continues, but if you are being led by the Spirit, you aren't under the law. Now, just to clarify, what Paul is saying is that when we are led by the Spirit, we will do what is right and have no need for the old law, the old system of do's and don'ts. We will learn to do right and to avoid evil based on something deep within rather than based on something imposed upon us from the outside. But again, living this way requires training. It requires knowing the difference between the various voices we hear within ourselves. It means having the discernment to tell the difference. And Paul provides us with some case examples to illustrate that difference. First, he lists the destructive behaviors that the flesh can lead us to when it is not subjected to the Spirit-guided conscience. The actions that are produced by selfish motives, and that is the flesh, I've switched translations here. The actions that are produced by selfish motives are obvious, since they include sexual immorality, moral corruption, doing whatever feels good, idolatry, drug use and casting spells, hate, fighting, obsession, losing your temper, competitive opposition, conflict, selfishness, group rivalry, jealousy, drunkenness, partying, and other things like that. I warned you, as I have already warned you, that those who do these kinds of things won't inherit God's kingdom. People who truly give themselves over to Jesus will increasingly distance themselves from these destructive attitudes and behaviors as they mature, as the Spirit takes root in their lives. But the Spirit doesn't just draw us away from evil, He draws us toward good. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against things like this. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the self, that is, the flesh, with its passions and its desires. The tyranny of the flesh, the tyranny of the untamed animalistic instinct, the tyranny of uncontrolled emotion, the tyranny of an ignorant mind, ended when Jesus died on the cross. We are no longer controlled by our flesh. Our flesh is now dedicated to the service of our Creator, who speaks to us by His Spirit through our conscience. And our task is to train the flesh to listen and to obey. So in the words of Paul, if we live by the Spirit, let's follow the Spirit.